Yes, Manny. All right, go ahead.
So our period three class decided to call our entire project the Minos Collaboration. And for the accelerator, so this is the basic design of the accelerator. While most accelerators have one synchrotron, we actually have four. And in the LINAC, before it can enter the four synchrotrons, it has to, the proton has to get up to about 330 GeV, and that's down by the two smaller synchrotrons you can see in the LINAC. And then there's 33 RF cavities throughout this entire design, 33 in the LINAC, and there's 8 in the main design. We collect protons with protons, and yeah.
A couple important numbers to know is it costs just under $4 billion. Every magnet in it is 13 Teslas, and after the three tiers of synchrotrons, it brings it up to about 6.5 tera electron volts of energy.
And for our luminosity, so right here I listed two different luminosities, which is the two-way collision luminosity, and that will probably be more likely than the four-way collisions that will happen throughout the accelerator. So that may affect our integrated luminosity over the first year. And then we have the luminosity monitor, and it's kind of a combination of diamond detectors and scintillators. It will just be a centimeter from the beam pipe, and it will be positioned around each of the exit holes from the tracker along the beam pipe, so there will be four of these.
Okay, and that brings us to the tracker. So the general structure of our tracker, it's spherical to account for the four-way collisions, so that way it's pretty evenly around the beam pipes. And our tracker is composed of 14 concentric graphene pixel spheres. Graphene pixels are similar to silicon pixels, but graphene has higher resolution, it's stronger, and it doesn't need as much cooling. And the beam pipes enter perpendicularly, obviously, into our spherical design. And the radius of the tracker is 1 meter, and each layer is separated by about 6 centimeters of space.
Our radiation interaction lengths are very low because we moved the return yoke magnet from the tracker to outside the EM calorimeter because it would decrease the space that the tracker needed, and it would reduce radiation interaction lengths. So the radiation interaction lengths that we calculate for the tracker are only based on the cooling mechanisms. They're the same number in our calculations because we use an averaging technique because the pipes are just very small and there's like 7 or 8 of them which the infrastructure group will get. So most of the radiation interaction lengths are moved to outside the EM cal. Graphene, due to it being so thin, doesn't really have a effect on the radiation interaction lengths. So we just essentially left them out of our calculations because it's knowledgeable.
So
let's wait. No. It's the wrong way.
My bad. So in terms of costs and statistics of the life, graphene is our most expensive material by far. It's around $20 million per meter squared. And so due to the fact that we have about 6.25 centimeters of space in between our 14 layers, there's actually a significant amount of surface area. So we covered the entire surface area of these concentric spheres with the graphene, and the total cost, as seen right here, is about $1.4 billion, which is a significant amount of money considering that our total budget that was originally given is around $1.5 billion. So after that, we needed a magnet, or the solenoid. So what we did in order to encompass the entire sphere of our graphene tracker is we used cylinders. We had cylinders right here, 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 and here. So we can see that it is a sphere and it is like a circle in this this reference frame, I guess you could say. So in this case, the cylinders have to change radius as it increases and comes towards the top of the sphere. So that total cost, well, the total cost of the solenoid was around $35.3 million. So the solenoid has a volume of around 35.2 meters cubed, and the cost of the material is around $1 million. So then the last part was our return yoke, and that is made of an iron material, which is around $120,000 per meter cubed. that return yoke will just surround the solenoid and the tracker. And so the return yoke will just encompass all of that material seen here. And so our total cost was around $1.5 billion. We got some extra money from other areas of our tracker, so we are right in budget.
Okay, now we have the resolution analysis. I'm speaking on behalf of Catherine Downey, who's lost her voice. But for angular resolution, it's very small because the graphene pixels have great resolution, so it's about 6 × 10⁻⁵ degrees. The momentum resolution, which is the highest momentum at which you can see the particle's path curve, is we have here about 2 × 10⁻⁰ kilogram meter squared, but that's about 375,000 GeV over C. And then for acceptance, which is more based on the geometry of our design, for vertical, so about like that way, it's 35.4 degrees, and then horizontally or parallel to the ground, it's 80.8 degrees.
So now we're gonna move on to TTC calorimeter, and we'll begin with the electromagnetic calorimeter. The electromagnetic calorimeter is a spherical calorimeter that is 1/4 a meter thick, and it is a homogeneous calorimeter. It is composed of lead tungstate, and lead tungstate acts as both a scintillator and an absorber. This saves space, and when you save space, you also save money. The ECAL has 180 latitudinal and longitudinal segments over 100 layers, and the photomultiplier tubes are on the outside, and we are totaling a total of 3,420,000 channels. And the photomultiplier tubes, or the phototextures, only take up about 0.68 cubic meters of space.
Alright, for our HCAL, we're following with the spherical geometry, so it's just continuing that. For our technology, we're using GRPCs, which are glass resistive plate chambers, and we're utilizing them within our calorimeter, making an imaging calorimeter, so it tracks it. We have uniform GRPC segmentation of 4 cm², and we utilize iron as our absorber. The spherical design has a volume of around 430 m², with inner and outer radiuses of 2.25 meters and 4.9 meters respectively. And we alternate between iron and layers of GRPC, with about 19 milliliters of iron for every 1 milliliter of GRPC. This all comes together to have an output of around 30 million channels.
So the newness of our hadronic calorimeter lies within the glass-resistant plate chambers and the software. And the software is an implementation of particle flow algorithms, which are used to kind of look at the entire shower, but then distinguish individual particles, which act as a good representation of the energy as a particle. And this is done by looking at the path along is with the linear energy. And the linear energy can be calculated because we still have iron absorber within the hadronic calorimeter, and just looking at that distance. And then the hit relation is done by an event builder within the program. Callus is an example of this. And it'll recreate the path to kind of see where on these GRPCs the particle hit. And this is done because we have a really high segmentation within our calorimeter.
So we're gonna use a lead tungstate scintillator for ECAL, and we have about 20 radiation units of this. And lead tungstate scintillator is about one of the most efficient materials for radiation. And we're gonna have 15 interaction links for the HCAL. This is mostly due to the iron absorber. The GRPCs are negligible. And again, this is gonna provide imaging analysis instead of measuring energy. And we're gonna have 100 layers of the ECAL segmentation with 180 longitude and latitude segments. And this will improve our shower shape resolution.
Okay, so that brings us to the costs. The grand total comes out to about $480 million. The EMCAL, because of the small form factor of the tracking detector, that means that we could also make our ECAL very small. And so we're able to afford Latungstick, which is still very expensive, although very effective. Since it's also within the solenoid from the tracking detector, which was factored into the tracking detector's cost, these had to have special shielding, so we multiplied the cost by 1.5 to account for the additional cost of shielding. And then for the hadronic calorimeter, the itemized costs are there. So $480 million is actually really under budget for us. We were originally allocated $1.5 billion. So we had room to either increase channel density or more or increase the number of gRPC layers for the hadronic calorimeter. However, we're limited in terms of infrastructure because the more channels we have there, the larger the entire cross-section of the cables that we need. So we actually had to limit ourselves to the channel density that we have now. And in fact, this grand total is an overestimate because in order to run the cables out of the calorimeter, we need to bore holes, which would reduce the volume of material that we need.
And next we have our muon detector. We call it TORCAT, which stands for toroidal iron cathode strip chamber muon detector. So once again, it's in the shape of a sphere, and there's actually a lot of empty space between the calorimeter and our muon detector because that'll give us better resolution. And because the muon detector is on the outside of everything, it has like a large surface area to cover. So this means that we need to use a little bit cheaper materials, which is why we used iron as our absorbing material. We have 48 toroidal magnets that are all 4 Tesla magnetic field strength. And we used a cathode strip chamber as our way of detecting because it offers like a competitive resolution and price. And we had the innermost layer at around 12 meters of radius, and then additional layers were at 0.5 meters. And we used the maximum. Okay, so
basically, yeah, we still have spherical design. We had half a meter of iron shielding, and then the cathode strip of alternating orientation. And the toroids were are actually in the layers of cathode strip chamber. The 48 toroids are broken up into 4 rings of 12. Like, so each of them sort of looping around the whole spherical design. So at 12.5 meters away from our interaction point and with 300 channels per meter, we're able to distinguish 2 beams that are about 0.012 degrees apart. We also have our 48 magnets, and with 4 Tesla strength in each magnet, we're able to measure a momentum as great as 90 GeV per C.
So with regards to cost, since this is the muon detector, so it is on the outside of everything, we need to cover a lot of surface area, so you need to use materials that are a little cheaper. So the iron shield, then we used, in addition, 48 4 Tesla magnets, and finally, cathode strip chambers, 9 layers of that. And actually, because we were able to find materials that were on the cheaper end, we were able to put a gap about 6 meters before the cathode strip chambers, and that's how we get a lot better resolution. Finally, we come out to 0.8 billion, which is under our $1 billion budget. And actually, taking this approach everywhere throughout our whole collaboration, we were able to go almost 50% of the allocated budget in total. So in total, we were allocated $6 billion, and we were able to get about $3 billion for the entire collaboration because of these cost-saving measures.
Okay, for infrastructure. For the cooling for the tracking system, because the graphene ladders conduct thermal energy so much better than the silicon ones, we only need to put cooling tubes around the equator of each sphere. As you can see on here, they're only 6 millimeters in radius, and they run in on one beam pipe and out on the next. in the concentric spheres like that. There are four stations outside of the detector that manage the cooling in each of the pumps.
Of course, with large magnets, you need a large amount of power. And also, you need to cool these magnets a lot because we want to have high electromagnetic resolution. So what we do is we pipe both power and liquid helium to these magnets, both the solenoid and the toroidal magnets, to keep them cool and to give them power. There, furthermore, for our solenoid magnet, it's inside both our V1 detector and our calorimeters. So we'll need to bore a hole through these items to make sure that our wires can fit in. And so we combine our magnet cryogenics and power with our V1 detectors and our calorimeters to have a total area, total cross-sectional area of around 0.1019 meters. And then finally, our holes will be located by beam pipes because this will minimize interference with the natural spray particles since they go at undue angles from the collision.
So we have about 260 or million readout cables that are going to go through our detector, and they'll weave between the spaces and wedges in our detector and the layers. And they will exit through two holes in the detector. For the power supply, there will be four power supply boxes. They'll be located outside the calorimeter alongside the beam pipes. And the power cables supplying the power to individual parts will be inserted into the detector through different holes that are located surrounding the beam pipes. So there will be four holes in each of the layers. And since the power supply boxes are located outside the calorimeter, there will be no need for the large holes in the muon detector.
So the muon detector will be supported by like a stainless steel lattice that it will just be put on top of. And then each of the individual magnets will be supported by a steel post that connects to the ground. And then the great thing about graphene for the tracker, which is like in within the sphere right here, is that it's like very light and strong enough so it can support itself, so it won't need like individual stainless steel posts to hold that, each of the ladders. And then at the equator, there will also be steel posts oriented like so. So they'll go through the muon detector and attach onto the calorimeter. And each of the posts will have like a little foot on the end. So then you don't have to like bore holes into the calorimeter and instead can just bolt it onto there. And each one will be 45 degrees from one of the beam pipes.
Good stuff. Do you have any questions for this collaboration?
Yeah. Hi, everybody. I'm Jim Dolan. I'm a physicist here at Fermilab. That was a very cool presentation. Everybody did a great job. I have a few questions. It was a 6.4 TeV beam, I think. What set the upper limit on how high energy you can go with your accelerator?
With the magnet strength that we had of 13 teslas, I think, and the radius of the
tunnels.
Yeah, the radius of the tunnels for the Glover synchrotron, that basically set the upper limit, and then so there's four beam pipes coming together, which should be a lot.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. So it's, you need a stronger magnet to go higher.
Yeah.
The graphene tracker was a cool idea. I've spent the last 4 years building a silicon tracker where we actually glue the silicon to graphene to get the thermal dissipation and stuff.
Oh, really?
It's a cool idea to just build a graphene. I was wondering, what sets the resolution of your tracker? Is
Each graphene pixel has a resolution, I think, of 10 channels.
So it's basically the size of the pixel, or is it?
What's great about graphene is the fact that cooling is not as much of an issue. we can get them much closer together. We can also, in terms of pixel, in terms of pixel size, we can also get that much smaller.
Right.
So the fact that we can get these so small and so close together, it just radically increases.
Okay. Yeah, so normally in a typical tracker, you have some number of pixels, but you need to cool and read out all of these pixels, and the fact that you can keep them cooler, you can pack them down, so that's a cool idea. Okay. So the tracker is a somewhat small tracker. What would have been the advantage to making the tracker just a bigger sphere? I mean, would there have been any advantages or disadvantages to making the sphere bigger?
Well, we chose, we originally did have it larger to accommodate more layers of more graphene that we could afford. However, it was like, so we talked with the other parts, other sections, and we decided to like shrink it down a little so that the electromagnetic calorimeter could be smaller too, and they could afford to use a, like all liquid, so to use that material.
Yeah.
So we kind of compromised. It was going to be larger, so we could accommodate more layers. We cut it down to accommodate that.
Yeah.
But what would you gain from having it larger?
So you'd have a higher resolution, so you'd have, more graphene layers.
Okay, yeah. Not just more layers, but just the bigger that arm, to get that, try to figure out how big that curve is. Yeah. But great, yeah. Cool. And then, I guess you said it was, I think you said you expected 7,500 tons of barns per year, I think. So that kind of implies it's got a pretty high instantaneous luminosity. I'm wondering, can you keep every collision that, there must be a lot of collisions per second. Are you able to keep, read out every collision, store it to tape? Or is there?
We have photo multiplier tubes set up around the luminosity monitors, but otherwise,
okay. So yeah, the luminosity monitors can kind of tell you how many collisions there actually are. So what I'm getting at is there a trigger? Did you learn what triggers are?
Sorry, we haven't talked about triggers.
Okay, I don't know.
You can tell.
Okay. Yeah, I can just tell you that current technology is kind of limiting on how just much data you can read out of all these cables at once and how much you can actually write to a computer disk somewhere. So that's often the limiting factor. So these type of high luminosity colliders, we actually just throw out something like 99% of the data, where most of the collisions are kind of glancing kind of collisions where there's probably nothing interesting. So those, your detector's still reading out all this stuff, but we have to design electronics to very quickly decide this is probably not a very interesting collision, I'm just not going to keep it. And then, so that's one of the hardest things to do actually in these detectors, is keeping the interesting data. You always wonder, are we missing something? Are we throwing out some interesting signatures? But and my last thing was, I think a toroid is a great idea for this type of collider where you have beams coming in from multiple angles. I think the solenoid may be a little troublesome, because the beams coming in this way, you don't know the momentum in the z direction, because the protons, you don't know how much momentum each proton has in that collision. So that's why we care about transverse and build this magnetic field that's kind of transverse to the beams. But when the beams come in the other direction, it's not going to work as well. But, yeah. So maybe a giant toroidal field everywhere.
Toroidal around the tracker, you think, might do it?
Like, maybe a fun idea, just a really strong toroid. Kind of weird magnetic field everywhere. It makes mapping out. Yeah, you need to precisely map your magnetic field so you can simulate it, and it makes that troublesome, but it'd be a fun idea. But otherwise, yeah, great presentation.
All right. Okay.